If we talk about your goal is to find a job, I should warn you guys that don't look at my portfolio.
You're listening to Art Heroes Podcast, the show to help you thrive as a digital artist. Tune in to learn how to transform your passion into a career. Get inspired by other kick-ass 2D and 3D artists and find out what it takes to be an art hero.
Hi, everyone. This is Maria JD. I'm your host at Art Heroes Podcast. Thank you guys for tuning in. And today I'm meeting Maria Panfilova. She lives and she was born in Moscow, but Maria's client expertise is very, very diverse and international. She's worked with Axis Studios, Blur Studio, Sideshow Collectibles, and many, many, many more. And today's conversation will be specifically useful for you if you're right in the beginning of your journey, because Maria describes her roadmap to starting as a character artist, as a 3D artist in general. So hope you guys make the most out of this. Let's get started.
Okay, we're live now. Welcome Maria Panfilova to Art Heroes Podcast. Woo!
Hi.
Thanks so much, Maria, for coming on the show. Such a pleasure to have you. And
thank you for having me.
Come on, seriously. Actually, your name has been popping up on requests from other people who actually listen to our podcast, and many of our listeners requested to have you. So, I'm just serving the audience and doing what everybody asked for. So guys, you asked, here's Maria.
Yeah, I don't have a lot in English. What I have on the internet interviews is more in Russia. So it's a good opportunity to talk with people in English.
Yeah. Well, and let's just do exactly that thing. So Maria, for the start, do you mind just introducing yourself and quickly talking about what you do now professionally? What are the projects that keep you busy, if you can,
Mm-hmm. So I'm a 3D character artist. I'm working in game dev industry, also animation industry, and also a little bit of collectibles. And I'm a freelancer, so I can switch between projects. And I started in animation industry in Moscow studio. It was 2012. Then I switched to game dev studio and worked for a year in game dev. And then I switched to freelance. And now trying to do all of that.
And basically now you're freelancing in between collectibles and character art in other sub niches.
Yeah, it depends what project is offered and what projects I like. It can be some projects are going to 1 month, some projects 2 months. So the average around 2 months that I do. Some of them were quite long. When I was freelancing, in one case I worked for 9 months into one project. It was game project. So at that time, I told everyone that I am a game dev artist because I worked in games for 9 months. But then I switched to another project. And this project, 9 months, it was closed. So it wasn't released.
Okay, interesting. So what made you change from working in the studio to go in freelance? Because I really want to explore this a little bit. And do you now prefer freelancing?
Russia have quite specific situation comparing to US. It's hard to compare because what we have in studios is industry is Russian industry. So Russian movies, Russian games. And we have also outsourced studios. It's another topic that do work for everyone within the world. But you kind of limited if you decide to stay in Russia. You limited what studios you have in Moscow. And if you want to have more choice, then freelance is the way to go.
Very interesting. So basically you're saying that...
One question is choice. Another question is money. So the salary is in Russia is lower than what clients can pay you as a freelancer if you work for everyone in the world. You have bigger market. And I think typically many people go into freelance at some point if they keep working in Russia, don't go anywhere, and many people go this way.
I see. Very interesting. But you still started as a studio artist, right?
Yes, and I recommend to, like, it's, I think it's a very good way to go to learn from a studio, to start from a studio. It was a great experience to learn everything I know.
Yeah, okay. But did you actually go to art school, or where did you get your, the basic knowledge?
So when I decided that I go into 3D, so it's, this is my field and I want to do that, I was 20 years old. And I was studying at university as a psychologist, and I had this decision. And before that, I had a hobby in like 12 years old. I learned building websites and doing flash animation. And it was at that time, it was very trendy thing that everyone was, anyone who wanted to do something creative, many people did websites, and flash animations was also the thing, because the video was too heavy for the internet, and some entertaining stuff was in flash. Do you know what flash is?
Yes, I'm like, you know,
I guess younger generation may not know, but it's like a cartoon movie, a little cartoon movies that you can do, and even if you're a very beginner, you can still play with it. And that was a thing at the time. But it was a hobby, and I didn't take it seriously. And when I decided who I will be studying at the university, art wasn't a thing to think about. So I went to psychology, and in the middle of learning, you really need to think what you do in future, and I get back to my past hobby as animation and computer graphics and a little bit of Photoshop, and I just figure out that 3D is a thing that I didn't try. It was very intimidating for people to learn 3D, because people knew 3ds that this program exists, 3ds Max, but yeah. when you enter the program, you see all menus, and it's all like everything is so complicated. And
yeah, I agree. People, yeah, when you just open it, it's like overwhelming when you have no previous experience.
Yeah, and the majority of people just open it, close, and remove the program.
Exactly.
And so sometimes they get back, like, let's try one more time. And with me, I was a little bit intimidated, but when I think about more serious about it, like, I researched a little, and I found out that actually it was 2010. There was already tutorials and very good quality tutorials. And when I discovered tutorials on how on learning Maya, I realized that it's really, if you just follow the tutorials, it's really easy. And I was surprised how these tutorials are good quality, that you can just follow them, and it's like, it's not even researching, if you're just following what instructing telling you to do, and you are not lost.
Yeah,
you know what to do. You just follow the tutorial and you repeat after the instructor. And it was a new thing at the time, because there was schools, but you have to pay for schools, big money, like for one semester, is like whole bunch of money.
Yep.
There was books, but books are really hard to follow. If you ever tried learn a software with book,
you just, you know, I was just thinking exactly about that. That my experience was learning Photoshop with a book. You know, like
I did the same thing.
It was actually, that was not that hard, because it was definitely easier than trying to sort it out by yourself without a book, but it was not that intuitive anyway. But it was
You need to do the whole job of looking at the page and looking back and find the number, find the menu, and if the book is about older software, you're in trouble, because you cannot find the menu that you was referenced to, and it's the whole problem. And tutorials are much more easy, and I just, from this discovery that I can learn by tutorials, I just switched from one to another and one by one. And so the starting point was like very fun, and I was studying at the time, so I had free time to do that.
Perfect. So basically you studied the software and just by yourself, and then went to find your first job.
I found my first job in 1.5 years after I did that. It was animation studio in Moscow. And what I also want to add about studios in Russia, I mentioned before that in Russia people try to go freelance because it's more choice, and it's in many ways it's better. And also many people try to go abroad and work abroad. And I think in studios in Moscow there's a very good environment for beginners, because they're in demand to find new people, because more experienced people go away. I'm not sure if it's the same now, because it's many years past, and maybe the niche is more busy than it was before. But what I saw back then, like big demand for people who do stuff.
Yeah, I also guess if you're serious about your own artistic career and if you want to learn, you will definitely be in demand in a studio, because not everybody's there are a bunch of artists, but not everybody is a really, really good artist. So, you know, kind of.
And game dev studio and animation, also films and advertisement. It's a quite big field, and there's a lot of job. There's more and more people now who get into that, and the amount of job is also growing.
One thing that I wanted to ask you is goes about your portfolio, because I know that you always say that you like that artists, especially beginner artists, should not look at your portfolio and think that it's something they need to build to get a job. So how does it, like, can you explain a little bit more?
If we talk about your goal is to find a job, I should warn you guys that don't look at my portfolio. Because what I post in ArtStation is what I do in my free time, and I already have a job. And when you do personal works, you have a choice what you want to do. Is it you're doing completely for yourself what you want to do, or you do it for finding a client and you try to adapt to the client's needs? For example, I want to go to some game dev studio. That's why I do some game character. In real time, I put it in the engine, I do all the optimization, and I prove that I can do character in a good quality. And this is way how you can do your portfolio. Another way, you just have your software, ZBrush, and any software that you have and know. And you want to self-express, and you experiment, and you're not put borders to where you can go. And that's actually what I did most of the time when I do personal work. So the models usually they don't have proper topology for animations. They don't have all the clear pipelines that usually needed in studios. They usually have poses, and game dev studios, animations, so they they need straight character in TPOS. So yeah, I'm not following the request in my portfolio. I'm not following the requests that clients need, but I do it only because I have a job and I can do that. And if your goal is to have a job, the focus is a bit different. You need to get a job, so you need to prove your employer that you can do all this stuff, all technical stuff.
Interesting. So are you saying that the goal will be different for an artist who is looking for a job versus for an artist who is looking for a freelance project? Because if you're looking for a freelance project and not necessarily a job...
No, I wouldn't say that.
Really?
Freelance and job is similar. Like, you need to prove clients that you can do that. And to do that, of course, if you have a lot of offers from clients, it's like you, since that time, you have some freedom that you can do whatever you want, and it will be fine. But if you have lack of clients, it's better to focus on that. When I started working in my portfolio, I had things that at the time when I started, I didn't do characters at all. I think it's important to mention.
Yeah.
So my portfolio wasn't about characters, and it make things easier to me because it's easier to learn how to do helmets, how to do houses, how to do some hard surface objects, and do it in a professional look.
Mm-hmm.
It's easier than characters. And so my portfolio was looking fine, because let's say I think important is like to find the nearest goal that you can achieve quickly.
Oh, cool. I think that's a great tip, actually. So you were not doing characters, you were doing like assets and environment, or what was it like?
Yeah, more like that. It wasn't because I don't want to do characters, but I was motivated to do the work that will look professional and that people will say, oh, it's a good thing, I like it. Like, in a way that people notice the quality. So when I started, there was a CG Hub and there was CG Society, most common website, but I didn't go there much. Instead, I went to Russian website, and it was for a reason. I will explain you.
Sure. So, yes, go ahead.
In ArtStation, you have all the world, all best people, you have best of the best, like everyone. And in the same thing in CG Help, in CG Society. And in a Russian website, it's like a pool of people, quite limited pool of people only from Russia. And when you look at their work, you think, okay, I can do that. Let me try to compete with them. First, I want to prove them that they choose your work for a gallery. Like, if your work isn't good enough, they don't post it.
Yeah.
If your work is good enough, they post it. And my first goal was to get into this gallery. And this goal is not too hard. You just need to follow some quality plank. And if you keep the quality level, they approve your work. And it's the first thought that I actually can do something professional. It was the first feeling that I can do that in real.
Interesting. Yeah, so basically what you're saying is keep increasing your plank and keep setting goals as you achieve them. So don't kind of shoot to the stars right away, but kind of go step by step.
Yes, I think it's very important nowadays, because we have Instagrams, we're following all these artists who have 10 years and more of experience we try to compare ourselves with them, and it's not productive at all. It's okay. It makes us disappoint in what we do, and I think aiming the right goal that is close to your achievement, and you see this, it is close and I can do that, and you do this little step, then you do another step and another step, and you have the rewards in this path because you really achieving it. Like I was, I achieved the going to into the this gallery, and it gave me the reward that I really proved to someone that I can do that, and then I can go further.
Wow, I love that. Thank you for saying this. I think this is a really great, great tip that, you know, just like taking things in portions, don't try to go all the way straight, but kind of a pace yourself.
In the internet, many people think, many new artists, that you post something and you have no reaction, like no comments. And I really feel that it can be really harsh to you, that you do your best, you do the effort, and you don't have a response on what you do. And at the time when I was working, I was in a really different situation where people comment in even into the bad work, but they still gave some comments because the community is small.
Yeah.
When the community is small, people are more into each other. They're more looking more carefully whoever posts something, and in this big community is another different environment. Mm-hmm. And for new people, like, smaller community, I think, is way better. Some chats can be really good. A chat in Discord, group of friends, and there's a lot of chats nowadays that you can find.
Yeah, but you know, like, I think the other thing that is very relevant from what you mentioned, like the size of the community, but also back in the day, the algorithms of social, like, networks were very different. And so nowadays, when you post something, and in most cases, when it doesn't get traction right away, so when people don't like, share, comment, whatever, like right away, it kind of gets lost. That's it. You will never see this work again. It will never show up.
You know, at the time, there were literally no algorithm.
That's exactly what I'm saying. It was just like the, you know, like the forum thingy or the chat. And that's it. There's no algorithm.
Yeah. Yeah, and algorithm is a very dangerous game.
Exactly.
Algorithm. So I think you can start play this game when you're ready, when you really think that you can beat this game.
Yeah.
You know, my first work that I posted to our station, and that it's present now, so I didn't delete it. It was after around 4 years I was in the industry, and I was working, and I had 4 years of experience. So all I did previous to that, you don't see.
Wow. Okay. Now I'm impressed. So I was actually going to ask what happened with your previous portfolio, but now you said it. Do you actually clean it completely?
No. So the thing is that our station appeared at some point, and I didn't post anything to CJ Hub. I chose not to post because I knew that I wouldn't. I knew that I don't beat this game. If I post anything, it won't be good enough, and people won't notice it. And I knew that. And so for this reason, I didn't post anything to CJ Hub. But I did post to this Russian website because their community is smaller, as I mentioned, and they're more looking more carefully what you do. Many people say Russian community is toxic, and people not only comment but also say bad things about your work. This thing is, you also should be careful about this. If you notice that people try to bring you down, you really should notice it, and you should like make your skin thicker at one point. Like try to filter the comments. It's very hard to do. I still didn't learn that to do completely. But also avoid, like, you see the environment like that in this community, maybe avoid this community, maybe go and look somewhere else, because there are good, there are better communities, there are worse and better, and you really need to find the community that people supporting each other, and don't trying to bring you down. It's very common thing.
Wow.
So small communities are good, but you should be aware of this problem of a toxic environment.
Interesting. So is it true that that community that you're referring to was a little bit toxic in a way? Is it about being Russian? Like, or not?
You know, in my case, in this website, it's called Renderu. I didn't see that really. I see that some people was inadequate and tell something toxic. And then moderator came and tell you doing a bad thing. So they started a discussion with this, like, people see that some person are toxic and they try to affect this toxic person and tell him that you're wrong.
Yeah.
It's not the point. And it was working really great that not only because if a toxic person says something bad and nobody reacts to that, it looks like it's okay to do. Nobody
I understand. That. Yeah, 100%. But then, yeah, if people kind of react and say that this is behavior that's not accepted here.
Yeah, and I think when it's happening in the comments, other people look at that and they adapt their behavior and they try to be more polite. When they see that toxic people are not welcomed, they, like, the community is healing by itself.
Okay.
But if people not react to toxic, it will spread. Like, they will see that it's a good environment to do this thing.
Yeah, I see. Well, very interesting. So, but, you know, what would be your strategy if you see that the community is not friendly? Would you just leave? Or like, what would you do if you get all these, you know, toxic comments?
I think nowadays to leave is easy because there's so many options where you can go. Mm-hmm. And if you don't like it there, you can go somewhere else. And yeah. And about, you ask about Russian, it's really a Russian thing. If you go to Russian forums and communities, like if European people go to Russian and know the language and read what they're talking about, they will be shocked, I think. it's so only because they don't know language, they don't see that. But
okay. So you're saying that, like, being Russian is being more negative?
100%, yeah.
Wow, bingo.
And being negative can be a good thing, of course, because a criticism is what people telling you what you do wrong. And it really can be a good thing. People being honest and they don't filter, they don't sugarcoat it. And it can be very, very helpful. On the other side, people do it for different reasons why they tell you negative. Sometimes not because they want to help you. That's the problem. Sometimes they tell you negative because you want to bring you down. And okay. they may tell it as, I want to help you. They may say, yeah, it's my tip, it's my advice to you. Don't do it anymore. Like that. Like, forbid this profession. It's not for you. Like, it's, I'm only wishing a good for you. And then they tell them that.
Oh my God. This must be so, so harsh. Especially if you've been working on a project for like weeks and months. And then you hear like, hey, here's the tip.
I'm not sure what is worse, like ignoring, no reaction, or these toxic comments. I'm not sure which one is worse.
Yeah, I don't know. I think these days both are pretty bad, because when your work gets completely unnoticed, that's also pretty sad.
Yeah, and that's why I'm telling about this, because I think lots of people struggle with that. That, like, I started to play this game with ArtStation only after 4 years of experience and professional experience and anatomy learning and a lot of stuff I did. I maybe posted it somewhere, but not in a big field of people. I didn't play it with algorithm.
Yeah, at I see. Time. I see. Yeah, really interesting. Like, Maria, thanks for sharing all this. This is great. Like, I just wanted to change a little bit the topic because there are other two things that I wanted to speak about today. And one of them is actually the current situation because we're still recording this episode in the lockdown. For you, it's just like the start of the lockdown. I'm a total veteran of the lockdown by today. I'm hoping that it's going to an end at some point soon. But anyway, I was just wondering how this affected you, how the situation affected you. Did you get less projects? Did you get more? And what do you think is the effect of the corona crisis on the industry of in general?
I actually have more projects for some reason. I don't know if it's linked with coronavirus, but I'm very busy with work now. For now, game dev is a lucky industry that have a lot of purchases of games and they're growing in this chaos, but we don't know what will be next. Maybe it's temporary thing and it will change into completely different thing. But yeah, game dev is in a good position. Film industry is in a worse position because you need to do shooting, and it all was canceled. Mm-hmm. And a lot of projects, I guess, stopped. But it's hard to predict how it will go. Maybe it will recover very quickly after everything will be over. So it's hard to give some predictions. But for me, like, I was working same way how I work now. What changed is I stay home and I don't go to gym. Instead, I try to exercise on the kitchen.
Yes, I do the same. Well, but good job, you know, like having you know, all of these projects. Congratulations, this is great. But you know, like, I guess to follow up on that, you're definitely not the only one who's getting more work. And it's not really rumors. I've been speaking to several artists and several people from the industry, and it actually is the time to finish projects. And I know that some projects are not postponed. So in many, many cases, it goes in their own like timeline. And obviously there's a huge positive of the crisis is that many studios go remote or kind of adapt remote work ethics in general. It should be great.
Yeah. Maybe if you're considering switching from studio to freelance, maybe it's a good time to do because everything was restructured and there is new spots that are available and they looking for people to quickly fill the gap. And maybe it's a really good time to start doing that. Mm-hmm. And my hope that in the future, freelance, like this crisis, will get some improvements to how people live and how, because we're breaking one habit and we're bringing in this time another habit. And some of these habits we will keep. Mm-hmm. Like remote work, my hope is it will be more, the culture of remote work will improve. Mm-hmm. Because I have 4 years of experience freelance, and I understand that there's a lot of limits to freelance. Some things are just better doing the studio, Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of good sides about studio. And I miss working in the studio. And there's something that I lack in freelance is like, for me, is the problem in freelance, the level of your involvement to the project, how deep you're into it, or you just, because, you know, the word freelancer is goes from a mercenary.
Oh, no, I didn't know, actually.
Free and Lance. Lance is a spike.
Yeah.
And it was from warriors who were mercenaries. And like how people see mercenaries, like they do a job for you, but they you don't really trust mercenary.
Yeah, okay.
Because he's a you're not building long-term connections sometimes because he will go away at some point and you will hire another one, so why bother to mm-hmm. build these connections? And I'm more for switching to a remote work, that you're building relationships with clients, you know more what they want, you're adapting to their needs, and you have a lot of back and forth. You have you're working with artists who work in house together. It's the best situation when you work really closely with artists and you have good communications. And sometimes freelancers have lack of it.
Yeah, but again, like, thank you for saying that. I think there is a lot that can be improved from the side of the freelancer, but it all requires an extra effort. You know what I mean? So it's an actually extra effort to force yourself to understand more and to give this extra communication to your client, or you can call them a partner on the project.
Basically. Yeah, and coronavirus is a good way to find these problems and try to solve them. So I guess it will naturally evolve into something really better for freelancers.
Okay, cool. And what do you think, what else can be improved in the whole, let's say, freelance culture, or like remote work culture, specifically in digital art industry? So like game dev and VFX and like CGI in general. So yeah. In terms of remote work, so you said that communication could be deeper, involvement in like the projects could be deeper, but what else would you improve?
I just maybe need to describe how it works in the world.
Sure.
With freelance. So nowadays there's a lot of outsourced studios that do some assets for bigger studio, and there's like, it's very trendy now to create your own studio and doing outsource. And this is evolving, and it's interesting to watch how it happens. There is something that I have questions about, something like one asset is being is breaking down to stages, and it gives the client gives this to different studios, and in one country you do high poly, in another country you do topology, low poly, and in the third country you do texturing.
Nice.
And
it
works. It's how the industry works. I don't have suggestions how to improve it, because I guess for some people it works well, for some people not. And yeah, it's hard to suggest how to improve it. I guess the system of doing, like one theory that I heard, that game studios goes into small teams, very small teams, where only game designers work. The brain of the game is in the studio, and all art side is being outsourced to completely different studio, and they do all the art. So this studio is only about ideas and plot and game mechanics, and this side is only about art. So this way to divide it is maybe good because it's completely different people working in.
Yeah, but like I see what you're saying, and but at the moment, you know, like the three countries that do like high poly, low poly, and texturing, they don't communicate to each other at all. Like they don't even know that they exist.
Yeah, and I think it's a way to evolve remote work that it can be about some piece of managing software that makes life easier to you and makes easier to communicate between parts of between studios. So I'm not telling that people are not doing it right. Sometimes it's just really hard to do it right technically. And some, like, we made an appointment with a calendar when we started interview, and this really cool calendar that you can
Calendly. Yeah, 100%. It's a really cool tool. Yeah, Calendly just makes all scheduling easier.
Yeah, you can automatically schedule time, and all time zones will be automatically adapted. Yeah. And these things like that, they make the life of freelancers easier. And I think technical advancement will really improve the freelancing culture and will improve all this system.
Yep, definitely. I agree. Like and small changes, small tools.
Until I forgot, I mentioned before, like, don't look at my portfolio. Where I can advise you to look, for example, if you type an extension, outsource, you will find a lot of pages that do exactly what is in demand.
Interesting. Love the tip.
A lot of studios, outsource studios, now have attestation pages, and they post what exactly they do for the client. And if you can keep your quality to level of these works, then you will have a job. There will be no problem to find the job. So your goal is to aim to this quality of studio showing their portfolio. And it can depend on style, like in AAA games, there's one thing that important to achieve. In stylized game, it can be completely different things. So you can aim for a studio.
I think that's a great tip, actually. I've realized that I've never done this type of search, but right after we finish, I'm just going to go to ArtStation and I'm going to like do this search too, just to find out what's there in the market.
And yeah, and there's quite a specific things that are in demand. I will always wanted to mention that because people sometimes not realizing that like making human bodies, for example, is not too much in demand in game dev industry because you have scans, you have base meshes that all studio use, and it already was done before, and you just take it and use it. What's in demand really heavily is clothing, armor, guns. So if you go to this outsource studio pages, you will see it by yourself. That if you aim to have a stable income, you need to adapt to this demand. And a lot of work that I did, it's this armor, and it's I done a huge amount of this job. And the more experience you have, the more you can go outside and try your own thing and try to persuade the clients that you do this thing good and please hire me for this thing. And it works.
But you can only afford like creating your stuff when you already have certain experience.
Yes, when you're busy when you're busy with work, but you also have a free time, you can continue gather experience and go into the direction there are less demand, but you still want to do it, and you can try to improve it. So like what I said about step by step, so you achieve this and then you try if you can achieve next stage.
This is so cool, Maria. Thank you so much. This has been really, really interesting. I think we almost decomposed the beginning of a career of an artist, and lots of really, really good tips. We actually have a little tradition on the podcast of going through a quick questionnaire of 10 questions. And I'm just about to put you through this experience, just if you're ready.
Okay.
Yes? Okay. All right, let's do that. So there are 10 questions, and you can reply with like 1, 2, 3 words, not like too many, okay?
I will try.
You will try. Okay, let's go. So what's your favorite place in the world?
If I need to same place, okay, Japan.
Japan, why? Okay, cool, amazing. While you're working, what are you listening to?
Audiobooks, YouTube, a lot of YouTube.
A lot of YouTube. Okay.
Music is less often, sometimes silent.
Okay, lovely.
I think audiobooks is the best because you're not seeing the image and it's less destructive.
Okay, what's your favorite way to gain inspiration?
Maybe too popular answer, like Pinterest?
No, actually, that's not a popular answer. Wrong guess, but but good tip. Pinterest.
But also going from Pinterest to the links that they're following somewhere else. And it can be really cool to go for links of the pin and go deeper.
Okay, down the rabbit hole, I see.
Yeah.
So what's your big life goal? First thing that comes to your mind?
I'm focusing on it right now, is keep my interest and keep creating all my life.
Okay.
And it's my goal.
Okay, amazing. Love that. What's your favorite drink?
Alcohol?
Doesn't have to be. Any.
Then coffee.
Coffee, perfect. I was wondering if it's tea.
Okay.
All right. So what's the first thing that you do in the morning?
It's chaotic and there's no certain thing. I'm quite chaotic freelancer.
Okay. Chaotic freelancer, Maria. Amazing. If you didn't become a digital artist, what would you be? Psychologist?
I can't say psychologist, but I should also say I think it's not for me, but
really?
I might look for, it's a big field. Maybe I will find something.
Okay, cool. What's your favorite book?
One book?
You can say, just recommend me one book, yeah.
Okay, I will recommend Gone with the Wind.
Oh, Gone with the Wind, cool. It's actually on my to-read list.
Yeah, it's a...
classic.
Despite it's old, but yeah. I think how it written is very, very good, and for more it didn't get old at all, I think.
Okay, cool. It's actually literally on my to read list for this year. I hope it's I'm gonna do this. All right, next one. Who are some of your legends? So some people that you follow, admire.
The most legends for me now, I guess, Simon Lee.
Okay, cool. Simon Lee, we'll put him in the show notes. And what are some of the things on your bucket list? It's okay, just give me one.
Okay, I can... This is very... I'm not sure you can say it as a bucket list. Have children?
Oh, definitely.
At some point?
Definitely, definitely goes on the bucket list, 100%. Okay, perfect. Do you want to drop anything else into the bucket list, or
if I understand correctly, bucket list is when you're near death and you're looking back.
Well, yes, you might say it is. It's actually a really good explanation. Yeah, something
and
like this.
You may regret that you didn't do something.
Yeah,
and. I guess I take it seriously. It's not a funny thing for me.
I mean,
that's that's why I mentioned like children that I may really regret if I didn't do that.
Okay.
Yeah, but I don't imagine like anything particular more.
Okay, cool. Love that. Okay, Maria, now that we are done with the 10 questions. Amazing. Thank you so much. I mean, you know, I personally learned huge amount of great small tips that can be game changer for somebody who's starting. So really appreciate that. You know, thank you.
Thank you very much.
That was really productive. And guys, I'm putting the links to things that we mentioned just here in the show notes if you're watching this video. And if you're listening to this in the audio format, there are show notes on our website. And just look for Maria Pinfilo episode just there. Well, yeah, anyway, bye-bye, Maria. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Ciao.
Thank you guys for listening and for your patience. There is a little surprise in the end today. Maria actually shared a 50% discount to her Gumroad tutorial that is about animal sculpting. And if you guys want to dig deeper into animal sculpting, I'm going to leave a note here in the video description if you're watching this on YouTube or on our blog on artheroes.co with the link. You can get 50% off Maria's tutorial. It's huge, seriously. It's over 12 hours of video, so you will definitely learn a lot. Thank you guys again for being here and see you next week.
Thanks for listening to Art Heroes Podcast. Check out www.artheroes.co for show notes, more interviews, and free tools made for you by our team of mentors. Tune in next week for more inspiration and keep up the great work, hero.